Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming today. My name is Nader, and I'm the Vice President of Business Development here at EA for the public sector. I'm happy to introduce Stephen Tapp from the Canadian Chamber of Commerce today. Stephen's presentation is focused on how the Canadian Chamber of Commerce leveraged mobile analytics to uncover workplace mobility insights. Now, Stephen Tapp is the chief economist at the Canadian Chamber, and in his role, he serves as a key member of the Chamber's executive leadership. He is responsible for the operations of the Business Data Lab, as well as economic analysis and research. His focus is on developing the Chamber's data and analytics capabilities to provide real-time, forward-looking insights for Canadian businesses of all sizes, in all sectors and all regions. In this presentation, Stephen is going to take you through the journey of integrating EA workplace mobility data into the Business Data Lab environment to provide insights into the rates of return to work across Canadian cities. So please help me in introducing Stephen to the stage.
Thank you so much, Nader. As was mentioned, my name is Stephen Tapp. I'm the chief economist at the Canadian Chamber of Commerce. And so I have to say I've been around data for, over 20 years or so in my research career. And one of the first meetings we had with Nader and EA, I was absolutely blown away by the depth and the detail and the flexibility in terms of applications and uses. So before I get into that, let me, if my clicker's going to work here, advance one. Uh-oh, we have technical difficulties. Oh, no, we're good. Hold on. Can I go back now? Are you going to just advance when I go? Okay, all right. So let me just, before I get into what we've done with the data set, let me just briefly talk to you about what is the Business Data Lab. So the Canadian Chamber of Commerce launched this about a year and a half ago. This is a partnership. So you saw Anil, the chief statistician there. This is a partnership between the Canadian Chamber of Commerce working together with StatCan, and we're funded through government funding. We have a mission which is twofold. Essentially, we're looking to improve measurement, but at the end of the day, really focused on understanding business conditions in Canada. This started through the pandemic where StatCan came to us to try to survey our members in real time to figure out where are the areas that are being most impacted, what sectors of the economy, what regions, where should we design government programs. We worked with StatCan to develop the Canadian Survey of Business Conditions, which is a quarterly survey now that's available. So that started the process, and then we decided we really would have some use cases here and try to build out a better understanding of Canadian business conditions, and so that's what we've been doing over the last while. You see my team there on the right. It's about five people or so. It's a relatively modest, I would say a modest size in terms of scope of budget and overall resources, but we've been able to have a pretty big impact over the last little while. And the end goal for us is really democratizing data. So getting data in the hands of our users, the stakeholders, include the chamber network, so chambers across the country, businesses themselves, as well as governments and analysts. So let me see if that's going to work again, or if I'm just going to just give you the nod. Okay, so the Workplace Mobility Tracker is what I'm here to talk to you about today. This is a tool that we have designed, working directly with data from Environics platforms to try to provide a comprehensive look at what's been happening to workplace mobility through the pandemic. I'm just going to give you the nod again then. All right, so for motivations, if we can all, we probably blocked all this stuff out, but if you remember back early in the days of the pandemic, I mentioned before, designing government programs and policy supports, there are also big questions of reading the newspaper. There were significant changes underway in terms of people had moved out of some of the big cities. Folks that had young children were looking for space. People could not afford places downtown. So there was lots of movements going on, lots of newspaper articles that were being written about the changes that were happening. So we basically framed this in the research side in following three questions. Which Canadian cities were leading and which were lagging, looking at the distribution across the country, in terms of the return to office, the workplace now data sets, very useful to answer that question. We wanted to combine our data sets with some other information we had to try to figure out what's really driving the patterns of these changes, and then also how persistent are those going to be. Next slide, please, folks. And so let me preview our main findings before I get into it for the rest of the slides and the details. We find very significant variation across Canada in terms of the cities, the CMAs, the downtown cores. And in particular, what we found is not surprising to most at this point now, but being able to quantify this and to track this over time has been very useful. So we have picked up in the data set a clear hollowing out of the big cities in Canada, the big downtowns of the big cities. So that includes Toronto, that includes Ottawa, that includes Vancouver. I'll show you some data now. And some beneficiaries of those actions were movements to, I would say, kind of commuter towns. So places that are about 1 to 2 hours away from the big cities have seen a big increase in the overall action and people moving to their workplaces as opposed to what we're seeing in the main downtown cores. That's seen some progress over time, but we're starting to stabilize. But that's kind of the big high-level changes that we've seen. We matched some of the data up with Workplace Now with demo stats, as well as some other data sets we have from StatCan, to try to figure out what are the main drivers of this. And I can list those there kind of in order of importance. Education, not surprisingly, the biggest influencer in terms of what's happening at different levels of community. So if you have a highly educated population with bachelor's or graduate degrees, those folks are working on computers a lot. A lot of those jobs can be done remotely. We've seen those places have a lot more uptake in terms of remote work. Family structure matters. So folks, for women in particular, we've seen more uptake of remote work with women. Families that have younger children and childcare arrangements have benefited more from that. The commute mode, so having commute mode in the data set as well has been useful. Looking at what happens when you have more public transit, which has been slower return to work, whereas communities that drive themselves and often drive in their own cars, they continue to go back to work much quicker. Industry composition matters, so I'll show you some slides on that. Places that had more construction workers were back to work quicker. All the kind of remote type jobs for information culture, IT, the types of things that you would expect, were slower. So if you can go to the next slide after this. And this is just the data background slide, so Natter and his team will be able to answer all of your very technical, detailed questions on this, but I'm sure people haven't worked with this data set before, or a lot of you in the room probably know it better than I do. But what the Workplace Now data set allows us to do is estimate the number of workers. So this is the adult population 15 plus, mobile movement data, so looking at folks that are taking their cell phones and going from their home to a common workplace location during the day. This is done in a privacy-compliant manner, and it's looking at the number of days worked. It can even drill down into the number of hours in different segments in mornings or afternoons or nights. It's very detailed. We're only using it now looking at a weekly data set. You can look at the number of days worked. You can aggregate up to monthly, as we've done as well. But a lot of flexibility in terms of the data set that you can see there. The data is defined around the census, so using the StatCan sort of census definitions, but also user-defined definitions, which I'll show you is how we've essentially ring-fenced off some of these different areas. So we report results for Canada, all of the provinces and territories. We drilled down to 153 different census metropolitan areas, and we focused on 55 different downtowns. The data set goes back to 2019, which is quite useful because you can look at what was happening prior to the pandemic that hit. With a lot of these newer, unstructured, unconventional data sets, we don't have a long time series, but we do have a very detailed and much more high frequency data on micro movements that we wouldn't have had before when you're looking at quarterly data, monthly data, which doesn't pick up quite a lot. Again, we've leveraged the data set with Workplace Now is the core of this, but we've added on to linking that with demo stats, which tells us a lot about demography, and StatsCan's labor force survey, as well as some research they've done on remote work. Next slide, please. So let me just show you an example for Toronto and for Ottawa. We took shape files, so you can do any kind of user-defined boundaries that you want. We've also looked at airports at one point during the pandemic to see what was happening with the return to airports. But this is just showing you on the left-hand side there, we're in downtown Toronto, obviously not surprisingly, but if you look at what the CMA boundaries are versus the downtown, and similarly for my workplace in Ottawa, we're working in downtown, but you can get a sense of what the CMA is. So the CMA being a bigger area than the downtown. And we didn't do much in terms of innovating with this. We just went to StatsCan, talked to their center of demography, and we're taking the shape files that they have. Next slide, please. So let me give you an overview of some of the changes that we had. We can go to the next one after this. So workplace mobility has fallen significantly during the pandemic. This is pretty obvious, but again, the point of this is to quantify that and to track it over time. And now we've sort of settled into a new equilibrium. Now I'm going to see if my clicker actually works, because I might need to. Okay. Workplace mobility, the dark line here, this is showing the overall numbers for Canada. So you can see we're indexing back to the change relative to January 2020, prior to the pandemic. We see a drop of about 40% at the national level. And then after that, there we go. The last lockdown, so again, we probably blurred all this out of our minds, but there were lockdowns that were happening over time in Ontario. There were actually still confinement measures early in 2022. So when you look after that last lockdown, you can see, there we go. What I'm calling the Economist here in the room, so I'm going to call this a new equilibrium. We've kind of settled into, after those last lockdowns, we've kind of settled into the new patterns that we're in. Right now, and that's a reduction of, you know, roughly 10% or more in terms of the number of adult population going back to their workplace at a national level. And again, I'm going to show you that there's a lot of dispersion across the country. So mobility fell most to the downtowns of Canada's largest cities. Let me show you here. The way I've structured the data now, the national number, which is the one in red that you saw, that almost 40% reduction, you've already seen that number. And now what we've done is aggregations for the CMA level, so Census Metropolitan Area, which is that broader definition of cities. When you look across all of the 153 different CMAs that we have in the data set, you can see that they have done a little bit better in the broader measures. If you narrow into the 55 different downtowns that we're tracking, you can see that the reduction was even larger. It's about 50% initially, and then now we're sitting around, let's say, minus 20% in terms of overall mobility movements back to workplaces. And the largest downtowns, when we look at the by population, so the 10 biggest cities in Canada, those have seen, I'd say, orders of magnitude larger, almost twice as large in terms of productions, about 66% on average at the trough. And that's come back, but still is, I would say, about three times larger in terms of the impacts for those areas. And of course, we have the data set, and so we can show these data in different ways to folks through our reports and through the dashboard, which I'll show you in a second. Relative to the pandemic, there's about 50% fewer adults that are traveling on a weekly basis to work in Ottawa, in Edmonton, in Toronto, and in Quebec City. I have here in this chart the top 10 cities kind of from west to east. And the dark purple is the downtowns, and the lighter, what are we going to call that, fuchsia, maybe? The CMAs, a little bit higher there. So if you look across the bottom, so the biggest changes in these top 10 cities have been it's in Ottawa, Gatineau, it's Gatineau. So Gatineau is kind of the biggest area that's been hit the hardest. Quebec City, Toronto in our data set now is still about 50% below what it was prior to the pandemic, and Edmonton. And what a lot of these have in common, Vancouver actually doing better. Montreal has been one of the outliers. Montreal had been one of the fastest to return to work across Canada in terms of the big cities. You know, a lot of these places have a decent share of the population working in federal government or provincial governments. So if you look at Edmonton or Quebec City, Ottawa, Gatineau has been pretty slow to get back to it. So we also did some maps, so geospatial kind of looking at the data to present that to our community. Cross-country results here. Natter liked this slide because we had used R to develop some, you know, much more detailed looks for users. But the main part of this slide is just to see that the very large variation at the national level. Across, we have some communities that about a year ago, essentially had a 50% increase in terms of mobility workplaces. And then on the bottom end of the spectrum, these much darker red, where there was a drop of about 50% or more. So there's just very wide variation across the country. So it really matters for place-based policies to kind of know for politicians or for businesses kind of what's happening in their local areas. This is the Homer Simpson chart. So this has been identified in the literature as kind of donut effects. So the hollowing out of those downtown cores and then the movements to the outer areas. You can see this very clearly in the Toronto data. So the darkest red, the biggest reductions in mobility. This is looking from February of 2023 when I last updated some of my maps. You see Toronto's down 45, Mississauga's down. But the areas around, so Brampton, Richmond Hill, Oshawa, Guelph, Cambridge, Kitchener-Waterloo, given a lot of IT jobs there as well, was hit pretty hard. I grew up in London, Ontario, and I can tell you that we had lots of movement from folks that were in Toronto that were looking for cheap housing and space in London, and so housing markets took off in London. There was big beneficiaries there for the first few years of the pandemic. I guess there's a lot of stuff happening with Sega Beach up there in Barrie and, you know, north. Folks kind of looking to commute in business services and those types of things. So that's what we saw there. For Greater Vancouver, the story is similar, where in the downtown Vancouver core, Burnaby, but if you look on the outsides, places like Chilliwack just saw a very big increase in terms of mobility. There, Victoria hit harder, and then same kind of donut effects that you see out there. I can show you some more charts for different cities. Calgary, Edmonton, Ottawa, Gatineau, Montreal, Quebec. So these slides, I'm assuming we'll just post these slides on the website maybe? Okay, and people can have a look through later, but basically what you see is these very dark red inner circles where mobility had fallen a lot. In Ottawa, for example, there's a lot more movement out in places like Arnprior, Stittsville, Carleton Place, Kanata, those kind of places benefited. And in Montreal, Montreal is hit pretty hard, but then some of the places that are commutable to Montreal or Calgary as well, with Camrose and places like that. So that's the commuter towns winning. We report rankings on the website for these 55 different cities, and so I can't do this in dramatic fashion because you can already see the answer, but the worst or the most hardest hit city in Canada through the pandemic has been Gatineau. So just across the river from where I am. And Longueuil in Montreal has been hit pretty hard. Kitchener-Waterloo, Edmonton, Burnaby. So you see Toronto there, 47th in terms of the return to office from the pandemic. So definitely hit pretty hard down around the bottom, close to 50% reductions. On the other side, the places, as I mentioned before, that have done well, places like Brantford, Richmond Hill, Brampton, Burlington, those are the commuter towns that we know well from here. And the overall data set, we've seen about 8 of 55 downtowns that have actually had an increase in mobility since the start of the pandemic. So that's the downtown rankings. We did some scatter plots, and then after the scatter plots, we did a bit more detailed work on the regression work. So the scatter plots here, which you probably will not be able to see with a lot of finite detail here, I just threw a couple in here just to give you a flavor for what I had said at the top. When we look at the relationship between mobility and the changes in mobility versus, let's say, education, which would be the percentage of population at a CMA or downtown level that have a bachelor's degree or higher, we see this negative relationship. So places where there's more education have been more likely to take up remote work, and they have come back to work more slowly. Similarly, among these top 20 CMAs, if you have more female population, we've seen more remote work there. Transit matters, so again, use of public transit, as well as those that are driving are actually coming back faster. So that's some simple scatter plots. As I mentioned, we did a little bit more detailed and rigorous analysis to try to control for different factors. These are regressions that are looking for these 153 different CMAs. I'm including fixed effects for provincial level impacts, and we're weighting these based on populations. The top line there is really that the bachelor's degree, of all the variables that matter in the data set to explain the distribution across the country, having a higher share of bachelor population matters the most. These other ones matter as well. These demographic factors too matter, but a little bit to a lesser extent quantitatively. And the explanatory power of these regressions is pretty good. So that's the regression part. We have data, I mentioned the Canadian Survey of Business Conditions, so we have some data on the industry breakdowns. And that gives us a decent sense of what's happening at an industry level. So this chart here shows you that essentially at the all industries level, at the very top, we've classified that in terms of remote. So people that are exclusively working remotely or mostly remotely, that's about 15% of the population by now. Overall, we have in the low 20s, between 20 and 25% of people are either working remote entirely or working mostly remote or partly hybrid. That number was about 5%. Prior to the pandemic, so we've gone from a 4 or 5-fold increase in terms of the percentage of the population in Canada that has been working remotely. And again, you can see wide variation in places like information culture, business services, professional services, real estate, finance, insurance. These types of things can be done online and don't need to bring people back in the office, at least certainly not 5 days a week to do. On the other end of the spectrum, it's your restaurants, tourism, accommodation type things. Healthcare, of course, largely be done in person. The retail area and agriculture. So that's the areas where there's very few people working remotely. Mobility dashboard. So this is just some screen caps of what the dashboard looks like. We've laid this out. So this was done as a Power BI tool. So bringing the data in from EA, We're running some codes, and we've developed our own Power BI dashboard, which you'll see in action in a second, but basically having some top box there, allowing people to choose through filters and pretty quickly and pretty easily generate results for their own communities. And the demographic comparisons is bringing in demo stats, as well as the labor force survey at the bottom, looking at employment shares. So this is a tool that we launched on the BDL's website, the Business Data Lab for Canadian Chamber. We've had 2,500 unique users in less than a year, so I was kind of impressed with the number of users we've had, and we have decent data on that that shows this has been helpful for businesses to understand, and chambers as well, to understand what's happening in their areas. So this may be the point in time where I need the folks to queue it up. There we go. So this is the demo video part. My folks have put together a little video, so if you can start that. What the point of this is just to kind of show you how this works in action. So there's, you don't need to use the blaring soundtrack. Okay. Everybody nod their heads. There we go. I asked them to put something so it wasn't just like static. But anyway, so you come to the website, you click, you drop down. This is the Environics sponsorship and partnership we've got here, so we're happy with that. As we're looking now into select your filters, you can look by geography. So let's say we're in Ontario, we pick provinces now. Now we're gonna select all the cities in Ontario. You can look for Toronto. Since I'm in Toronto, I asked them to pull out Toronto. We can toggle between weekly and monthly frequencies. We're looking here around the city, areas like Markham. You click on one of those on the side, which is already ranked for you. You get time series charts, so we can compare Toronto to Canada as a default, and then user-defined comparisons. So let's say what's happening in Montreal versus Toronto. You can immediately see those and look at the data points. Demographic comparisons coming from demo stats to try to understand what's happening, and then the labor force survey there, which tells you the shares of the industrial compositions in these different places. So that's pretty much the tool. I think you can reset your filters until your heart's content. So that's the demo video. Thank you very much for that, team. Appreciate it. And you can find this on our website right there. The Gain More Insights, the farthest on the right-hand side, you'll see the Workplace Mobility Dashboards. That's one of four or five main tools we've released over the last year. We have a Business Conditions Terminal, which pulls together almost 2,500 different indicators on a daily basis, which is structured thematically in eight different dashboards for folks to track what's going on with forecasts, labor markets, business conditions, and the like. A local spending tracker where we're working with payments data from Moneris to figure out what's happening at the local level for 35 different regions in Canada to track what's happening with consumer spending patterns. The CSBC, so the business condition survey I talked about, we have a survey insights generator where you can generate your own results from that too as well. So there's that. Let me conclude. So there we go. Environics data has helped us in a very significant way to try to track the return to office across Canada. We've been able to do this quickly and pretty localized, and we're happy with the results we've had. Next bullet, we've noticed big differences across cities in these areas, and these are driven by factors I mentioned before, like you would expect. Demographics and commuting patterns have mattered. The downtowns of Canada's biggest cities have been hit hardest, although some of the commuter towns seem to have benefited from that. And I think we're settling into this new equilibrium where the world is kind of adjusted to the pandemic, and hybrid is obviously here to stay. So there's some open issues in the data set that we haven't really poked into but are important for remote work. The first is productivity. So if you look at surveys and you talk to workers, workers will tell you that they're more productive when they work at home. And if you ask managers, managers will say that their workers are less productive if they work at home. So I think there's certainly some work to be done. It does depend on if you're fully remote or if you're hybrid. Remote entirely seems to potentially have issues with either observability or motivation or other things, but of course you're able to pull from a different pool, you can hire from different areas, you don't need to pay real estate costs as well, so the productivity wage trade-off, how much are you paying somebody if they're not working in market, those issues have been important. On economic development, so we have seen some challenges to the downtown cores, especially for businesses that are serving, let's say that there were, at least in Ottawa, there were the office employees that were coming in, the laundromats that had been hit pretty hard, lunchtime or those types of places that were having significant difficulties in terms of getting their economic business models still going. Of course, at the same time, it's been useful to those commuter towns. Real estate, we've seen a big drop in demand for downtown commercial real estate, so what's going to happen to those markets? On public transit, we don't have a lot of ridership. Do we get into some death spiral where you have fewer people going? Then that has to increase the cost of these, and then we have trouble keeping those going viably. Inclusion is important. So remote work has been helpful for people with disabilities. It has encouraged more people to get in the workforce. It's been helpful particularly for women and for families with young kids, which is very good. At the same time, with the mentorship or personal development or professional development, it's not obvious that when people are looking for promotions, or on the other side, if people are looking to fire, the first people that they may be firing may be those people that are not in the office. And so issues about career progression, I think, are real and important to consider. So there's my contact information. So again, I'm Stephen Tapp, the Chief Economist of the Canadian Chamber. Our business data lab has been up and running for about a year and a half. So we would be happy if anybody wants to have a look at the data, chat with us about opportunities to work together. You can, you know, get a hold of me on LinkedIn or send me an email.